Hi guys and welcome to episode 6 of Shakespeare Sunday. In today's episode we'll be discussing the play that is Othello by Shakespeare, and it is a play completely filled with betrayal, murder and a romance story between two characters. Which is the common, I feel this is a common plot of every Shakespeare play, you know, because there's always, there's always betrayal, there's always murder, and there's always love between two couples, which probably always ends in, you know, tragedy, because yes, this is a tragedy by Shakespeare. So let's just, get a start on with it. So the simple summary for Othello is, there's a character called Iago. He is furious about being overlooked for a promotion as he's in the army, and he plots to take revenge against his general, that is Othello, the Moor of Venice. Iago manipulates Othello into believing his wife, that is Desdemona, is unfaithful, stirring Othello's jealousy. Othello allows jealousy to consume him, he murders Desdemona, his wife, and then he kills himself. And that is pretty much the story. But if you would like to know the more detailed version of the story or of the play, please just move on.
Act 1. Before Othello begins, Rodrigo has been pursuing Desdemona, a Venetian noblewoman. One night, he hears from a soldier friend, Iago, that Desdemona has secretly married his general, the Moorish Othello. Iago bears a grudge against Othello for overlooking Iago for a lieutenant position. Instead, Othello chose Michael Cassio, leaving Iago only at the low rank of ensign. Iago urges Rodrigo to continue his pursuit of Desdemona. He knows Senator Brabantio, Desdemona's father, will dislike having Othello as a son-in-law. So late at night, Iago and Rodrigo wake Brabantio and tell him the news of Desdemona. Brabantio angrily summons the militia to arrest Othello. At that moment, officers arrive to summon Brabantio to an urgent meeting of the Senate. The Senate is concerned about the imminent threat of a Turkish invasion fleet on Cyprus. Full of fury, Brabantio goes to the council. Brabantio interrupts the council, claiming vengeance against Othello. Othello is already there because he has just been put in command of the forces to repel the Turks. Othello explains how his stories of military prowess have helped him earn Desdemona's love. Afterwards, Desdemona is called to reinforce the tale and defend her marriage. Following Desdemona's defense, her father disowns her, and she chooses to go with Othello on his campaign. She plans to travel in the care of Lieutenant Cassio and with Emilia, Iago's wife. Act 2. In Cyprus, Montano, the governor of Cyprus and his soldiers greet Cassio, Iago, Desdemona and Emilia as they disembark. Othello soon arrives with news that storms at sea have dispersed the Turkish fleet. A night of celebration is proclaimed. Rodrigo confesses doubts about his potential to woo Desdemona, but Iago assures him that there is hope. He urges Rodrigo to challenge Cassio to a duel that night, since Desdemona is actually falling in love with him. When the night comes, Iago gets Cassio drunk and Rodrigo incites his anger. Montano, the governor, is stabbed during his attempt to contain Cassio. Othello is angered by the fight and blames Cassio, stripping him of his recently conferred officer status. Act 3. The next day, Iago convinces Cassio to ask Desdemona for help in regaining his post. When Cassio asks, Desdemona innocently agrees. Meanwhile, Iago has sown seeds of jealousy in Othello's mind, suggesting that Desdemona is overfond of Cassio. With no reason to suspect Iago of bad intentions, Othello begins to watch his wife. Othello becomes angry when Desdemona cannot find the first gift, a handkerchief he had ever given her. The handkerchief is embroidered with strawberries and especially important to Othello. But Desdemona had not lost the handkerchief. Iago had instructed Emilia, his wife, to take it. Iago then hid the handkerchief where Cassio would find it. When Desdemona urges her husband to reconsider Cassio's demotion, Othello gets jealous and suspects her of infidelity. Act 4. Iago continues to inflame this jealousy. He encourages Othello to listen in on and misinterpret part of a conversation between Cassio and his mistress, Bianca. Cassio and Bianca discuss how Cassio obtained the embroidered handkerchief that he then gives to Bianca to copy. Othello's agitation at what he hears brings on an epileptic fit. After recovering, he orders Iago to kill Cassio. Desdemona cannot understand Othello's change of attitude towards her. Othello even strikes her in the presence of relatives, Lodovico, who has arrived as an ambassador from Venice. As she prepares for bed, she talks with Emilia, singing to relieve the distress she feels at losing the trust of her husband. Act 5. Meanwhile, Rodrigo has begun to suspect Iago is not quite the friend he seems. Still, Iago persuades him to attack Cassio that night. In the fight that ensues, Iago goes undetected and wounds Cassio. He then enters again as himself to accuse and kill Rodrigo for the act of wounding Cassio. Othello comes to his sleeping wife's bedroom to murder her as punishment for her supposed adultery. He smothers her with a pillow as she asserts her innocence. Emilia alerts the household, causing Iago and the others to come to the scene. Othello defends himself, mentioning the handkerchief as evidence. Emilia realizes what has happened and betrays Iago's plots against Othello. Iago, reacting to his wife's accusations, stabs and kills her. Iago is arrested and sent to trial after Othello wounds him. Othello, facing the inevitability of his own trial, uses a hidden weapon to commit suicide. The play ends with Cassio reinstated and placed in command as governor of Cyprus.
So that was the summary of the play, and now I would like to discuss the themes of the play. So the first theme that we observe in the play is prejudice. So the most prominent form of prejudice on display in the play Othello is racial prejudice. In the very first scene, Rodrigo and Iago disparage Othello in explicitly racial terms, calling him among many other things like Barbary, horse, and thick lips. In nearly every case, the prejudiced characters use terms that describe Othello as an animal or a beast. In other words, they use racist language and they try to define Othello not only as an outsider to white Venetian society, but also as a black person. So as you guys know that, before, in the history of mankind, slavery was an issue, was a very, very bad thing that happened to black people as a whole. And especially during British and, in American plantations, they used to take black people and they used to make them as slaves, work in plantations and all that. So in the play, it is portrayed how being a black person, even though if you're a high position of a general, as a general, the person, even though he is black, he is judged on the color of his skin rather than the potential or his own talents or activities. So one thing that I would like to focus on is prejudice, and we need to reduce this in our everyday life. We need to reduce the prejudice that we give to others, rather the person on their potential, on their character, rather than the color of their skin. That is very important. So the next theme of Othello is appearance versus reality. The tragic plot of Othello hinges on the ability to mislead the main characters. That is, you can see the villain of the play, that is the antagonist, is Iago. He misleads the other characters, particularly Rodrigo and Othello, by encouraging them to misinterpret what they see. Othello is susceptible to Iago's plots because he himself is so honest and straightforward. So every time Iago, he persuades or he convinces Iago or Othello to, Desdemona is doing this, or Desdemona is in love with you and she's not in love with Othello and all that. It is a very, very hingefully, plotted kind of thing. And Iago is very, very skillful in that. And he is very successful in totally destroying the romantic love story of Othello and Desdemona. And in the end, as we know, you know, Othello kills himself, and Iago is taken into prison, and you know, the whole story ends in a huge tragedy because of you know, his misleading and because of his cunningness. So that is it. Another main theme of this play is jealousy. And one thing that I would like to say is that when a man or a person or anyone, when he or she is jealous, they are on the path of their own destruction. And as you can see, I'll give reference in the Bible. You know, Cain was jealous of Abel because, you know, God bestowed blessings on Abel rather than on Cain. You know, that is one thing that I would like to say, that jealousy will destroy a person. Here, Iago, he was jealous. He refers jealousy as a green-eyed monster. And as this metaphor suggests, jealousy is closely associated with the theme of appreciation, appearance and reality, at a discussion in the previous one. For instance, at one point, Othello demands that Iago provide ocular proof of Desdemona's, you know, being infidel, and he demands to see reality. But Iago instead provides the circumstantial evidence of the handkerchief, which Othello, who is consumed by his jealousy, and he accepts it as a ocular proof. So there was this handkerchief, I think if you had listened to the detailed summary, it was a handkerchief embroidered with strawberries, which was the first gift that Othello had given to Desdemona. And when Desdemona is not, you know, able to find the first gift that Othello had given to her, Othello is just, he's confirms that, you know, Desdemona is infidel and she is cheating on him. So that is one thing. Jealousy, man, please don't be jealous. Just be satisfied with what you have and work harder to achieve your dreams. Another theme of this play is deception and treachery. In Othello, Othello simultaneously believes he is being deceived by characters who are honest, while failing to see the deceit and treachery of characters who are tricking him. Othello refers to Iago as honest multiple times in the play, showing that he is totally blind to the way Iago is tricking and manipulating him. Othello is so deceived by Iago, he believes Iago is actually incapable of lying. While Othello is naively unable to see that Iago is deceiving him every step of the way, he is also stubbornly convinced that Desdemona is deceiving him, that Desdemona is also cheating on him. And when she is being totally honest, once Othello makes up his mind that Desdemona is guilty, all her claims of innocence only enrage him further, because he is convinced that through the lines of the play, this is a subtle whore, a closet lock and key of villainous secrets. Everything Desdemona does to prove her innocence comes across to Othello as further proof of her guilt. Othello's inability to correctly identify who is and is not deceiving him makes him act rashly and ultimately lead to violence and finally tragedy. The final theme of the play is justice. So in Othello, characters justify their actions on the basis of deserving justice. The first character we see seeking justice is Brabantio, who is the father of Desdemona, who is outraged, you know, that his daughter has married a man of a different race, and decides that Othello must have bewitched her, you know, that Kala Jadu thing, yeah, that was still there even during Shakespearean times. And he feels that Othello bewitched her. And Brabantio asserts that I therefore apprehend and do attach thee. He seeks legal restitution for the perceived violation to himself and his honor. However, Brabantio's apparent demand for justice is rooted in his racial prejudice against Othello. See, we come back to the first theme, that is racial prejudice. However, Brabantio is later on, you know, he disowns Desdemona. And later Desdemona goes to war along with Othello, and she's under the care of Othello. What Brabantio envisions as justice is actually the reassertion of his racial and gender dominance and power over others. As Othello becomes, you know, increasingly convinced that Desdemona has been unfaithful to him, he also feels entitled to seek a form of bloody, self-administered justice. As he tells Iago, "My bloody thoughts with violent pace shall ne'er look back, ne'er ebb to humble love, till that a capable and wide revenge swallow them up." While there would have been legal procedures in place at this time for bringing charges of adultery against his spouse. You know, in during those times, you know, Othello is not interested in seeking official forms of justice. He wants to punish his wife himself, and he feels entitled to do so. When Iago suggests that Othello strangle Desdemona rather than poisoning her, Othello notes, "Good, good, the justice of it pleases." Othello. So I would like to give a message from this play, but you know, betrayal, treachery, lies, jealousy, all that are the common things that have been discussed in various moral stories and in various plays, you know, throughout the history. Like anywhere you go, all the moral stories, the lesson is don't be jealous, don't tell lies, don't be treacherous, don't betray, even in the Bible. And I would like to tell you something from a feminist point of approach. From the play, you would have noticed that, and I told regarding the women thing, that Othello, he sees Desdemona as his property. He does not see Desdemona as a person or his partner or his beloved. When he understands that, you know, Desdemona is cheating on him, he just wants to punish her himself rather than go through legal procedures. He just wants to just punish her, and he smothers her. That is, he takes a pillow and pushes on her face and suffocates her, which leads to her death. And what I would like to say is that in our country, women have faced a lot of abuse, and there's been a rise. There's never been a downfall. There's always been a rise of domestic violence, and you know, our society overlooks this and says that you know, it's not our problem. Like neighbors, they can hear, you know, the husband beating the wife, and the neighbors say that, you know, they just want to listen in onto the fight. Like they listen, they want to know what is going on, but they're not going to help out the lady, that is the wife or the lady of the house, who is being abused by the husband. So that is one thing I would like to, you know, focus on, and that is domestic abuse. One more thing is that, you know, women have been discriminated a lot regarding salary wise. You know, the man and the women, they're in the same position, but the woman is getting paid 25% to 30% lesser than the man just because she's a woman, even though they're doing the same job. Another thing that I would like to focus on is that even during household, the daughter and the son, the daughter is not allowed to go out after 6:30 or 7, and she has to be inside the house by 7 in the night, whereas the son or the man of the household, he can leave anytime. He can just go out and have fun, and that happens just because he's a boy. And to be honest, we can't blame the parents, because they are being safe, they are being paranoid, and we can't blame them either, because our country is like that. It is not safe outside after 7 p.m. or after 11 p.m. anyways, it's not safe only. So that is one thing. So we must strive to work together to make this country a safe place for women. And that is my message from this video. So thank you, and I'll be seeing you next Sunday on another episode of Shakespeare Sunday. Until then, bye bye, goodbye, namaste.